Welcome back, everyone. We are now on item 12, final actions. We will go to M7, and that is Counselor Davis Harris Jones.
Oh, I got it. Thank you, Madam President. M7 is supporting the City of Albuquerque's application pending before the New Mexico Public Regulation Commission to grant Albuquerque Fire Rescue full EMS transport authority. I move a due pass.
Second.
There's a motion and a second for a due pass. We actually have some people signed up to speak. Mr. Brian Breezewine, followed by Tad Naminsky, followed by Sue Flint.
Good evening. Hello, everyone. I would first like to thank President Pena and the City Council for allowing me to speak. My name is Brian Breezewine. I'm a paramedic lieutenant with the Albuquerque Fire Rescue, and I'm also the vice president-elect for the city chapter of the Albuquerque Area Firefighters, IAFF Local 244. I'm here today to speak briefly on the IAFF's support of Issue M7. Tonight, representatives of Albuquerque Fire Rescue are here seeking support from the City Council towards the City of Albuquerque's pending application to the New Mexico Public Relations Commission to grant the Albuquerque Fire Rescue the full EMS transport authority in the City of Albuquerque. As it stands today, the Albuquerque Fire Rescue is the authority having jurisdiction here in Albuquerque, but does not currently have the same full EMS transport authority as private ambulance services working within the city. This thing makes more difficult when the department is trying to adjust our community services to better serve the city. With a matching authority, the department will be able to better serve the community by allowing it to be more creative, more efficient, and more effective with the resources and responses to EMS calls. Over the past few years, the department has seen a steady increase of call volume throughout the city. We feel that AFR having the full EMS authority would help in reducing redundancy in the 911 responses, and allows the department to get more creative with how it responds to these increases in call volume. In order for the department to continue to be successful, they need to be able to continue to move forward. Having the full transport authority would allow them to continue this progressive movement. This is why the Albuquerque Area Firefighters Local 244 strongly supports the department's actions and is seeking your support as well. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Mr. Tad Naminsky, and the final speaker will be Ms. Sue Flynn.
Thank you. My name is Tad Naminsky again. Well, I was really surprised about 3 weeks ago when a supervisor from Presbyterian paramedic called me and wanted to make an appointment with me to talk to me. Yes, so we made an appointment. He was on the time, and we had really nice, I was really surprised. We had nice conversation discussing. So anyway, here is what's going on between partnership between governments. City of Albuquerque and UNM. UNM takes mandatory 90 hours to see doctor at emergency room. So what is the time response fire department Albuquerque now? Well, maybe somebody give me an answer. So anyway, just getting critical when government start taking over businesses. Only one thing I can think, like in communist countries, Russia or so on, when percentage is owned and dictated, businesses being dictated by government. Here, what is it? Become bigger and bigger issue in Albuquerque, pretty much take over. All rules and regulation. What about Mary Hahn? Yes, I'm sure paramedics show up to Mary Hahn. And what's happened, we will talk enlarged later on. Thank you.
Thank you. Our final speaker is Ms. Sue Flint.
Thank you. You know, in May 22nd, 1989, I was on my way to work over on the south side of the airport. I worked out at the general aviation area, and I just started learning how to fly. And I was hit head-on, and the policeman had told me that that was the first time he had ever seen a direct head-on. In 1976, Monte Carlo hit me at over 100 miles an hour, and I was in my little Plymouth Colt, and it just exploded. But the first people on the scene after somebody found me were the paramedics and the fire department. And it was the fire department's paramedics, EMSs. And I have to tell you that I'm here today because of them. And had they not been the responders, their first taking the actions they had, I not only might not be here, but I would have lost my leg because I was hurt extremely bad, but mostly because of the pressure of putting my feet on my pedals and then having the impact. And so I would encourage you to support them, and I believe that they do a better job. You know, personally, I was my parents' caretaker. Whenever the fire department had to come out on a call, they were the first ones there. They were the ones that had the empathy and understanding of what we were going through. When Albuquerque Ambulance, and I don't like to down them, when they would come there, it was strictly business, and you can't do that when people are critical or you're losing somebody. And I just feel, honestly, that I personally, in the many, many times that I've seen, they're the first ones at a scene. And I think that they're the most qualified to decide when we should be transported or not, because Albuquerque Ambulance decided that they were going to transport me where the fire department was going to airlift me. And I'll tell you, it made a difference in my recovery. And I personally owe my life to them. So I encourage you to please support this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, is there any questions from the counselors? Councillor Davis.
Thank you, Madam President. I won't prolong this, but I do want to acknowledge that the chief of AAS is here and gave us a brief statement earlier. If it's okay with the president, I'd like to ask him to come up just so that we can ask a few follow-up questions, since this is something we've been working with him on for a number of years.
Sure.
Chief, would you
chief
join
Dow?
Us? Or, sorry.
Oh,
AAS chief. Chief, thanks so much for joining us. I appreciate it, Chief Casper. Sure. I just wanted to follow up and say, I recall, and I'm hoping you can refresh my memory just a little. I recall maybe 2-3 years ago when we were reviewing AAS's contract with the city and response rates. We found that there were some deficiencies in terms of availability. We, at the Finance Committee, as I remember, under the old administration, extended that contract, but there was some sort of compliance plan that AAS had put in place in order to decrease those times when you were non-available or weren't meeting protocols. And it just seems to me, based on what we've seen, that somehow or another that compliance plan hasn't been able to get us to where we needed to be. Can you talk to me a little about what we've done, what AAS has done in terms of trying to live up to the standards established by the contract?
Sure. I appreciate the question, Madam President and Councillor Davis. First of all, I want to say I assumed the role of chief at Albuquerque Ambulance Service about a year and a half ago. So I can't speak to, and I wasn't with the organization
yes, sir.
Prior to that. So what happened prior to my arrival is nothing that I can really speak to from a firsthand perspective. I can tell you what we're doing now. And I can acknowledge full on that you're right. There have been issues achieving compliance with the response time intervals or numbers that we have agreed to in the contract. We have been and will continue to be working diligently not only to achieve but exceed those, and we're working very hard on the issues that are underlying the reasons that we have not been able to, primarily in my tenure. We've had a staffing issue in terms of the number of paramedics that we've employed, which we've significantly improved, particularly in recent months.
Chief, I don't want to interrupt you, but can you, Madam President, if I may, just very briefly, can I ask sort of when you talk about a staffing gap
yes.
and what you've improved, can you tell me sort of where you were and what's different over whatever you've done lately?
Councilor Davis, I'd have to get back to you with the specific numbers. I didn't bring those with me, but ballpark, for example, a year ago, we were in a deficit of more than 30 paramedics based on the budget that we created, which would be, if fully staffed, the budget that we'd need, I believe, in order to achieve the response times. We've cut that to more than half of that deficit at this point in time. We've been really focused on our recruitment and our retention efforts, and believe that we're continuing to make progress in that direction. If you look at our response times over the past number of months, we are making, on a month-to-month basis, steady progress towards meeting those response time standards that are in the contract. So there has been incremental improvement. No, we are not yet compliant. I'll acknowledge that right up front. I'm not going to try to dodge that. But my goal is to continue to improve our department. My goal is to continue to provide better service to the city of Albuquerque, and I believe we're doing that.
Thank you, Madam President. I'd like to be able to follow up at the very end, maybe before close, but I see other councilors have questions.
Councilor Winter.
Thank you, Madam President. So I guess I don't understand. You're still not fully staffed, and from what I've heard, you haven't been fully staffed or met the contract obligations in 10 years. So why would you have a problem with AFD going to the PRC to get full transport availability? Why would you be against that? Because you're telling me right now that you still are not up to what the contract says, correct?
So, Madam President, Councilor Winter, so yes, we haven't met compliance with the contract. As I said, we're continuing to improve on a month-to-month, on a day-to-day and week-to-week basis. We are not opposed to working with Albuquerque Fire Rescue on improving and changing the way the delivery system works. And we've made that very clear. We also, however, don't believe that there is a need for another agency to have the full authority. We believe that within the construct of the current limited authority that AFR has, that we have the ability to work together with them and create innovation, create change. We continue, as I mentioned in my earlier statement, to transport 99% of all patients that call 911 in the city of Albuquerque. 99% of the time, Albuquerque Ambulance Service transports those folks to the hospital. So we believe that we can continue to work with AFR. We want to continue to work with AFR in a collaborative way in order to improve the delivery of care here in the city, but okay. Don't necessarily believe that a full authority is warranted.
So you are against, Madam President, so you are against them going to the PRC to get full authority for transport. Is that correct?
Councilor Winter, we're in the PRC process right now, and we have opposed
you have opposed
authority request, and that's being, it's in process of hearings as we speak.
And I guess I don't understand it, because we're responsible for serving our constituents. Do you pick and choose who you transport? Do you transport down and outs?
Sure, absolutely.
So you don't pick and choose who you transport?
That's correct.
Okay, I've got some more questions, but I'll go ahead and yield the floor.
Any other councilors have questions? Councilor Winter.
Madam President, can we have AFD spokesperson come out? Because I'm getting some information, and so if you'd be available after again, I'd appreciate it. Answer
absolutely.
Some questions. Thank you, sir. Want me to start? Okay. Thank you, Madam President. So I guess I'm a little confused. I know that we're responsible for making sure that our constituents are transported in emergencies and that we don't have to wait for them, that they get medical care as soon as possible. So under the current contract and the way that your authority, is that happening or not?
Madam President, Councilor Winter, we currently hold a limited transport certificate, which we achieved a few years ago. One of the things that we've learned with that limited certificate is that we are the only EMS provider in the state with a limited certificate from the PRC. All other certificate holders either have full authority or no authority. So we're unclear of why we have only limited authority that was granted to us several years ago. What limited authority does is it binds us to our contract with our vendor, Albuquerque Ambulance, and the contract dictates when we can transport. So we can transport in five instances: a critical patient, level zero, which means there's no ambulances available, a delay, a city employee, or a immediate family member of Albuquerque Fire. But those are all linked to our contract. So we contract with many vendors. This is the only contract that we have where our authority is really linked to our vendor. We have to basically ask them for permission.
Hey, Madam President, one more question. Does this affect the care for our constituents not having that full authority to transport?
It complicates care. We on scene, we are, if there's a critical need, we will transport. So we will make sure that the care is provided to that constituent. Where our concern is with the delays currently is that a lot of times when someone calls 911, whether they have a language barrier or they can't articulate their medical concerns to our dispatchers might code that call a low acuity call. So it might come in as just a routine sick call, but they're really having a heart attack. So on those low acuity calls, we send our engines with our basics, and there's no transport. We don't send our rescues on those calls. So our concern is with the delays that we are seeing right now, that it's further delayed when that transport decision is needed because we have the delay from Albuquerque Ambulance, and our engines have to then call out our rescues to respond with them. So that is one of the concerns that we have for the constituents.
Councillor Gibson.
So thank you. This actually clears things up a little bit for me. And I'm just wondering if are you aware of a time where there's been such a delay that it added to the acuity of the sick or injured person? Has it compromised their health, I guess, is what I'm asking.
Madam President, Councillor Gibson, we have several instances where we've had delays on critical calls, gunshot wounds, trauma, car accidents, things like that, heart attacks. If the call comes in that critical nature, they mm-hmm. are still receiving a response from our paramedics, and so the delay wouldn't affect the care because we would load them in transport. The ones that we would be the more concerned with would be those low acuity calls that would end up being a higher acuity. I don't have any specific instances, but we do know that we have how many times our engines will have to then request a rescue for a transport.
Okay, so you have seen instances where someone maybe called in with a low acuity, there was a delay, and that low acuity became a moderate or a higher.
Yes, I mean, I can, Councillor Gibson, I can attest to that from personal experience being in the field several okay. years ago, to where I was on an engine as a paramedic with that skill level, but I wasn't able to transport on the engine, and we would respond to a down and out or another kind of low acuity call and get there, and with my abilities, I'd be able to assess that it was a higher a critical call, and then have a delay from the ambulance and have to call to rescue. So I've been on those calls
okay.
before.
I have, Madam President, one more question, and that is, should you get this, is it a license? What were you calling it, a certificate? How would AFR respond to calls? I mean, would you just send out a rescue unit, or would you send out an engine, or what all would go out?
Madam President, Councillor Gibson, there's kind of unlimited possibilities of what we can do with our system. We have the benefit, in at least at AFR, we actually have all of our rescues staffed with two paramedics. We also have paramedics on our engines. So we have quite a few paramedics that we can get creative with the system. What the certificate of full authority does for us as the agency having jurisdiction is it gives us equal authority to our to private ambulance in the community. It gives us that equal authority to kind of match our responsibility that we have to the citizens of Albuquerque.
Right.
And so it kind of, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm just saying, I guess I'm just trying to find out, would major equipment be dispatched, or would you just typically have to send out the rescue unit, or do you need the whole family there?
Madam President, Councilor Gibson, that's a great observation of our system. So we have a lot of redundancy in our system right now.
Yeah.
And with that authority, that gives us the ability, excuse me, to look at the resources that we have and try to be a little bit more efficient with how many resources so that we're not sending out necessarily the whole family to every 911 call between the resources Albuquerque Ambulance has, AFR has. We feel that we can start to look at deployment models that would be more efficient and not send out the whole family.
Yeah, you guessed. That's what I'm getting towards is efficiency. Mm-hmm. You know, it just seems like I've seen so many times, I'm sure we all have. In fact, I've known people who've worked in places where they've had to call an ambulance or something like that, and, you know, they send out an engine, you know. So I know you guys do a good job, and you certainly don't want me as the boss person of Albuquerque Fire Department, but I would hope that I would hope that this wouldn't, you know, by getting the certificate, I would hope that it wouldn't just mean that, you know, more times than not, whether it's necessary or not, that much equipment goes out instead of what's actually needed. That's all.
Yes, ma'am, we completely agree with you.
Thank you.
Councilor Borrego.
So I have a couple of questions. So when a call comes in for an emergency, is it the first group to arrive that takes care of the call? Is it like if you got there before the other vendor, then you would take care of the call? Or if there was another group, if they got there first, whoever gets there first is the one that responds. Is that correct?
Madam President, Councilor Borrego, the way that our system works is that the call comes in through our dispatch center, and then we dispatch, and then Albuquerque Ambulance also dispatches a unit to that call. Depending on the geographical location of those two different units responding, you may receive the fire department on scene first, or there are times where you might receive Albuquerque Ambulance on scene first. Typically, the way that we work together on scene, we've been doing this for so long with our two-tier system, is if Albuquerque Ambulance is on scene first and then I get on scene second, we kind of follow the lead of the paramedic that's already established rapport and patient care so that we don't break down the continuation of the patient care and assist, and kind of vice versa. And when we're on scene first and then they arrive while we're on scene, we work together to treat that patient.
I'm understanding that if this memorial goes forward and PRC approves it, then there's a layer in there, if you arrive first, that you would not have to call Albuquerque Ambulance to get permission. You would actually just deal with the situation. So there is sort of a timing issue?
Madam President, Councilor Borrego, that could be one possibility. There's other possibilities. As far as right now, we have to wait until our contractual time for them to respond is up. So with a delay, we would never wait. I want to reiterate that we would never wait with a critical patient. So if we were on scene with a loved one having a heart attack and there was a delay, we would not wait we would transport. However, on other calls, the delay, we do wait for them to arrive to transport per the contract. And so that would give us the ability to not have to wait and then to just initiate that transport if our providers on scene felt like that was the best for that patient.
Thank you.
Okay. Did you have another question? I was going to put it to close unless you have another question.
I just had a brief question, Madam Chair, if I could follow. And then,
Councilor Davis.
Madam President, I'm sorry. Thank you, Chiefs, and thanks. I just want to sort of reiterate a point here and just be sure we're clear. We're talking about the Transport Authority. In other words, AFR responds on the scene. Sort of AAS currently is sort of the transporter from you. The theory behind this two-tiered system, I assume, or at least it was back in the day, as I understand, sort of let the fire unit stay in the field. They're more accessible. They can get back in service quicker, let the sort of the run-of-the-mill transport, even sort of critical issues, happen moving into the private health system, right? My concern here, and Chief, I appreciate, Chief Casper, I appreciate very much that you weren't here, and I know we've been working with press, and y'all have been a good vendor for a really long time. I think this sort of highlights the challenge we have in privatizing, particularly public safety issues. I think when you call 911, I think you expect the government to respond, and you expect us to be able to make those changes quickly. You expect us to be able to make those decisions, and that we can hold, we, the administration, the city council, the elected officials, can hold people accountable to those outcomes. It is a challenge when we have a vendor that can't meet those expectations. I agreed to sponsor this resolution, and again, it only says to the PRC, we're asking for our full certification to be on par with our vendor so that we can make those differences. And the reason I think this is important, and this is sort of my close, Madam Chair, is that, or Madam President, that, like I said, I did this 3 years ago. I agreed to sponsor the extension against the recommendation of the administration at the time because they brought us a plan. AFR stepped up and supported their vendor and said, we think we can work with them. This is workable if they meet their goals. They quite frankly haven't, and I'm worried about outcomes for our community. We just saw tonight that AFR is doing their own innovation and trying to improve those outcomes. I'm confident in the work they can do, and I'm confident in the work of AAS personnel. I've seen them in the field. I know some personally, but I feel challenged that so far, in the 4 years I've been here and apparently in the six before that, Presbyterian has not been able to meet their own goals and fulfill ours. I think it's time for us to step up and sort of cajoling, arm twisting, and asking nicely from elected officials and city project managers and contract managers has not gotten us there. Perhaps a little friendly competition would help us do that. And if not, I want to be sure that we're not, someone who needs care is not waiting on a private vendor when a city service could be provided. And perhaps that means we need to invest more money in extra paramedics and other things. But I think we're there. It's been 10 years. Like I said, I stepped up and sponsored the last extension because I believed that they had the right plan, and AFR asked us to do that. But quite frankly, I think our patience is running thin, and I think it wouldn't hurt a little bit if you guys could have a chance to do the full job. And so I would encourage and urge your support.
Okay. Councilor Winter.
Thank you, Madam President. I just had one more question, Councilor, if it's okay. We're talking about resources. And so if you're sitting there waiting for the contractor to come pick someone up, doesn't that cost more resources because you're on scene and you have to stay on scene till that happens? Is that correct?
Excuse me. Madam President, Councilor Winter, that's accurate. So when we are waiting for a resource to transport, that is tying up resources. And typically, like I said before, the resources that are tied up waiting are our engines or our ladders, which are our frontline responses for a fire. And so that's an additional concern, is that wait time is also putting that unit that can't transport out of service longer.
Thank you. So I don't know if that was your close, Councillor Davis and yes. Councillor Jones. Okay, so with that, there's a motion and a second for approval of M7. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Opposed, no. Motion passes. Thank you. So we are now back on item E, Councillor Davis, R212.
Thank you, Madam President. I know our staff from Economic Development and Aviation have been waiting patiently for us this evening. We appreciate it. R212 is a resolution relating to the proposed relationship between the City of Albuquerque and the Economic Development Department and Aviation and the SBIC for promoting economic development at the airport, that North Runway ACE project that we've been working on for a number of years. And so I would move a do pass on R212.
There's a motion and a second.
Madam President, I see that we have our staff here available, Mr. Minicucci, as well as Director Allen from Aviation, and I can't see that far without my glasses, but I think that's Ms. Armijo from EDD, if they want to answer any questions. But this essentially is approving the process by which we can start providing relocation and recruitment services to fill that location on the North Runway in an oversimplified way that's far more complicated than that. But.
So there is no one signed up for public comment. Administration have anything to add?
Madam President and councilors, this is really the first step in having a conversation with the SBIC to use, hopefully invest New Mexico dollars on New Mexico projects. And we think this is a great opportunity to hope to kick off the development of the ACE project, so we urge your support.
Councilor Davis to close.
Urge your support.
There's a motion and second for R212. All those in favor say yes. Yes. Opposed, no. Motion passes. We are now on G087, amending certain provisions in section 411 ROA 1994 for the fiscal agent ordinance to add the chief financial officer as a member of the investment committee and to update the types of investments allowed for cash balances not required for immediate disbursement to ensure this ordinance coincides with the recently enacted statutory amendments pertaining to investments of cash balances not required for immediate disbursement. I move a do pass.
Second.
There's a motion and a second for a do pass. No one signed up to speak. Anybody from the administration? No. So with that, I will close. I urge your support. All those in favor of 087 say yes.
Yes.
Opposed, no. Motion passes. Councilor Benton, R215.
Thank you, Madam President. R215 is amending R17233, enactment number R2017-095, to extend the effective date of the interim procedures while the Neighborhood Association Recognition Ordinance is updated. I move a do pass.
There's a motion and a second for a do pass. We have one person signed up to speak under public comment. That's Ms. Sue Flynn.
I wish I could say that I'm on a roll of being nice, but I don't support this bill. I'm so sorry. I was here at that hearing in October of 2017, and I actually spoke out on it because I had been working with the IG, David Harper, on something that I had found within the Imperial Building. And one of them was a condition of Neighborhood Association being formed. And there was quite a bit going on at that time, if you remember, about Borealis overlapping with Silver Street. And Ron Casillas came in here and he pointed up at Suzanne Lubar, who was the planning director at the time, and had been for 20 years, I think, the real estate attorney for Paul Silverman. And it was the authority that she had to make the decision if they were going to be able to create a neighborhood association. So what bothered me was when Ron Casillas stood up and said that you should pass it, and he pointed to Suzanne Lubar, and I knew that she had a conflict of interest, but you know, I look at things differently than you do. And so I don't agree with this. I think that many of these things, when we start getting into neighborhoods who are historical, that we are getting into vested rights. And I have to tell you, for the last 6 months, I've been studying not only your redevelopment plans, but other plans that with the city that affect the vested rights of neighborhood associations, homeowners associations, people who live in neighborhoods where all of a sudden planning has changed and other kinds of buildings are coming in. So I would ask that you defer it, give the public more opportunity to come out, because as you can see, I'm the only one here. And I believe that the public needs to have more input. I know you're going to probably vote on it tonight, but I just needed to come out and say it. And another thing, Councilman Winter, I feed feral cats. I got to go run. I'm going to be out until midnight. I believe in the animal control
trap and release. So spayed and neuter, everybody. Mm-hmm. And Happy New Year. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Bye.
Thank you. Councillor Winter.
Thank you, Madam President. Councillor Benton, I know that there's been some talk about continuing this, but having a procedure where neighborhoods that wanted to form could form.
Yes.
I know that the Inner Coalition had talked about that.
Right.
Is there still any possibility to do that? And how?
That's in here.
That is in there?
Yes. So along with the extension of 6 months, and just so everybody knows, I think Angelo's here. He could probably speak to this as well. You don't need to come down unless there are any questions, Angelo. But basically, we've done a lot of really robust neighborhood engagement, and that's been a long process, but we hired a really good consultant team that's been out giving every possible opportunity to try to hear from the neighborhoods. And the exact same thing that you and I heard when we met with the Inner Coalition group is addressed in here. So I think not only are we providing some extra time for us to
great
discuss and debate a rewrite of the neighborhood recognition ordinance and try to improve it. We're not trying to control anybody or make anybody do anything that they don't really want to do. Just very simple feedback, using the feedback that we've achieved through this contract. Hopefully we'll be able to write a better neighborhood association recognition ordinance, or leaving the good parts and strengthening the areas that need to be strengthened. But this does, this legislation clarifies that in areas where only recognized or non-recognized association, where the only recognized or non-recognized association is a coalition, then they can still apply for a new neighborhood if there's no other neighborhood representation
great
existing in place. So I think it may not solve every concern or eventuality that people are concerned about, but it should make it easier for
right
people to go ahead and apply.
Okay. And Madam President, Councilor Benton, I think that was one of the issues that I have heard,
mm-hmm,
is that they still have the opportunity to do that.
Yes.
Then that's a good thing that they can do that.
Absolutely.
While we wait for the rest of it to be.
And really, I have to say that was not my intention when we started with this, but that's the way it was interpreted. So this makes it clear
great
that we can do that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Winter. So Councillor Benton to close.
I urge your support.
So there's a motion and second for R215. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Opposed, no. Motion passes. Councillor Gibson.
Thank you, Madam President. I started out very organized. They're not so much now. So I'm going to move a due pass on R221. This is establishing that the city should not collect and should not withdraw any demands for collection of any fees and costs associated with lawsuits relating to its investigation of the death of Attorney Mary Hahn. I'm moving a due pass.
So there's a motion and a second. So we have two people signed up under public comment. That's Mr. Tad Naminski and Brian.
Thank you. My name is Ted Nimitsky. Well, we know that it's not only paramedics show up at Mary Hahn house. When she was pronounced dead. Now, so also any everyone from the mayor office but Mayor Berry, including chief of APD, well, they determined quickly. Oh, let me go to background. Well, she was partner of most powerful attorney, lawyer, Paul Kennedy. I believe that he's still justice, a new chief justice. So she wanted her out. That was an issue. Then there was, we also know another, that she sued the city all the time. That's why they show up from the city. So here is everything to me, as I understand, those are facts. They were publicized on the Albuquerque Tribune. Everybody knows. So to me, it's very clear that it's cover up. That's pure cover up by the city. City should be liable. 5,000, I believe that was 150,000 they were asking from her family, something like that. Now 5,000, what's that big joke? Well, that is, should open door to family to Sioux City.
Thank you. Our final speaker, Brian McCutcheon.
Madam President, and City Councilors, I spoke earlier, so if you have questions, I'd be glad to answer them. I'll go ahead and relinquish the time, unless you all have some questions.
Thank you. So, Councilor, any questions from the councilors? No? So, Councilor Gibson, to close? Oh, Councilor Borrego, sir.
So, I appreciate Councilor Gibson's sentiment, and I only know about the media coverage that I read regarding this and our reports. But I have a question of legal, and I'd like to know if, in doing this, does this violate any anti-donation?
Madam President, Councilor Borrego, thank you for your question. The legal department does have concerns about the resolution and possible violations of the anti-donation clause of the New Mexico State Constitution. Under the New Mexico State Constitution, a municipality can't either directly or indirectly pledge credit or lend money or make any donation to a person to aid them. The court's order basically constitutes and orders the family to pay a debt to the city of Albuquerque. And so in an analysis from legal, we believe that that would be a violation in passing the resolution, and that the appropriate method would be for us to continue to try to discuss possible settlement with the attorney for Hans Estate. And so I think that Lawrence also wanted to speak to this as well, but we would like to continue those discussions and are trying to reach out to council.
Mr. Royal.
Madam President and councilors, this is a very unique situation where I think that there is a lot of, shall we say, concerns on many, on everyone's side as it relates to this situation that occurred years ago. I would respectfully ask the council and Councilor Gibson if you all might consider giving us a two-week deferral on this bill so that we can continue to do as our city attorney has just relayed to you, and that is to have a conversation to try and get to a reasonable settlement of this case so that we don't have a precedent-setting situation by doing a specific legislation for a specific legal issue that could create other issues for us as a community, as a city down the road. And I will say to all of you that the sentiments you all perceive, and especially the sentiments that I think that, that Councilor Gibson has expressed as it relates to this case, the administration shares those concerns. We don't believe that things were handled appropriately, but we like to ask your support in doing this deferral just so that we can have one more opportunity to have a conversation with their attorney and perhaps move on this issue and close the chapter on this very, very challenging situation for the city. Thank you.
Councilor Davis.
Thank you, Madam President, and I appreciate that, Mr. Rowell. I share those concerns, although I don't want to hash out the details of this particular case or ongoing settlements here in a public forum, or it's not the right venue for that. But I do just want to ask the sponsor, I'm not making a motion, but I want to ask the sponsor if she would consider a two-week deferral to allow those conversations and to have a more definitive date of when that those conversations need to happen between the attorney and the parties. So not a motion, but just an ask of the sponsor if she has considered that option and how she might respond.
Councilor Gibson.
Thank you, Madam President. I have considered it. However, you know, I first went to City Legal 1 year ago, and we talked about this, and nothing has happened in that year as far as negotiating an end to this. So, no, I really want us to take action on this tonight. And actually, what I'd prefer to do at this point, if it's okay with you, Madam President, if our staff attorney can kind of summarize exactly what is in this resolution.
Mr. Melendres.
Sure, Madam President. Councilor Gibson, the resolution sets forth some recitals that discuss kind of the history of this matter, including the circumstances leading up to where we are today. It was a federal lawsuit in which the city requested that the city won in that federal lawsuit on all claims and ultimately submitted a request for attorney's fees. The federal district court entered an order for attorney's fees that was referenced in the amount of $5,000. The recitals also set out that subsequent to that time, a state court recognized some concerns with the way that the homicide investigation was handled and directed the Office of Medical, New Mexico Office of the Medical Investigator to change the cause of death to undetermined. This is all reported in the media as the result of a court case in the First District Court of New Mexico. And after setting up that history, the resolution then suggests that it'd be in the best interest of the city and residents to not pursue the collection of attorney's fees or costs in this or related suits relating to the investigation of Ms. Hahn's death. So it sets out that position. If the council were to vote on this resolution, it would essentially be sanctioning this position that it'd be in the best interest of the city not to pursue collection of that amount.
Councilor Gibson.
Yes, Madam Chair. So it, the idea of the city maybe having a problem with the anti-donation clause with respect to this, can you address that for us, please?
Madam President and councilors, there is a potential anti-donation issue there. I can't say that I would disagree with Ms. Holtz's representation of that. The resolution, as crafted, you know, sets a position, the policy perspective of the council. I think that if this resolution were to be enacted by tonight by the city council, it does not technically direct the city to take any specific action. And so the resolution in of itself, although coming very close to that issue and perhaps even complicating that issue, does not itself necessarily constitute a violation. It would only come to that instance in the event that the city did relieve some debt under improper ways that would present an issue under the anti-donation clause.
So an improper ways would be like if we were directing the city to go back to the court and do a formalization of forgiveness of debt. Is that what you're talking about?
Madam President, Councilor Gibson, I think there are limited ways that once debts are owed to the city or another public entity, there are limited ways in which those can be disposed of. And there would have to be a pathway to do that in order to not be presented with an anti-donation issue. I think settlement of a legal claim is a way that can happen. There are other ways that the city can sort of write off debt as uncollectible. So there would have to be a pathway that would technically permit that process to happen.
There would have to be a pathway for us to get in the way of the anti-donation.
Madam President, if one of the appropriate legal pathways were not taken and some other action was taken as a result of this resolution, then we would likely have a problem.
Okay.
Councilor Winter.
Yeah, sorry to belabor, Madam President, but so are you saying it is for us to vote on this tonight, Are you saying it is or it is not against the anti-donation clause? I mean, I can't quite...
Madam President, Councilor Winter, I'm sorry if it wasn't clear, but the resolution is, I mean, the act that could potentially violate the anti-donation clause would be the actual technical forgiveness of a debt. The resolution, by enacting this resolution, the city is not forgiving a debt. It is, the council is stating a position on whether or not the city should even be in the business of collecting this debt. So if a subsequent step were taken, then I think we'd certainly be confronted with that issue if there were a step taken through an improper method to forgive any debt of the city. But the resolution itself does not, I think, go as far as creating that issue specifically.
Madam President, but you're saying, so if we support this and then the administration goes ahead and tries to collect the debt, then we're,
so
then we could be in violation.
Madam President, Councilor Winter, so the resolution states that it's in the best interest of the city and its residents to not pursue collection. So if the council enacts this tonight and the administration subsequently says, okay, fine, that debt is forgiven, then I think we'd have an anti-donation issue. If the council enacts this tonight and no further steps are taken other than the council has made its statement, then I don't think we'd be confronted with that issue.
Councilor Gibson.
Okay, so this resolution does not do that, though. This resolution does not direct either a city legal or finance to make any adjustment or to do anything to forgive the debt. What this resolution does is just state an intention that the city not pursue collection.
Madam President, Councilor Gibson, I think that's correct. It states an intention that the city should not pursue collection, that it'd be in the best interest of the city to not pursue collection. But it does not... It does not forgive the debt itself, and that's where the issue is at.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Jones.
Madam President. What it does not, this resolution does not stop the city, the administration, from acting either way. We're just making a suggestion.
Madam President, Councilor Jones, I think that's correct. And so it's unique in a sense of a resolution because the city usually enacts a resolution to set policy that is expected to be followed. The particular language as written, and we've discussed this in this chamber over and over about the distinction between a should and a shall type of distinction in a policy. And as I think we know, for better or worse, sometimes a should isn't as meaningful as perhaps sometimes the council would have preferred. In this particular instance, I think understanding the sponsor, it was proposed deliberately to have that type of language that by voting for this, the council is expressing that the city should not be in the business of doing this. But it doesn't give a directive of what anybody shall or shall not do relative to following any legal obligations.
Before I go to the city attorney's office, so would this set precedence for other people to come to this body to request the same type of waiver?
Madam President, I don't know that it would set, I can tell you, it will not set any technical precedent. It will not force the hand of the council to do anything that would not otherwise be within the policy preference of the council in the future. However, it could certainly send a message to folks that this, avenue is viable. If people are out there that owe something to the city or that have a judgment from the city, that maybe this is something that they could try to pursue as well.
Okay, and then before I go to the city attorney, one last thing. What has changed about this case since the last time it came before this body?
Madam President, the last time it came before this body, the federal court had not yet entered an order to grant the city the ability to collect attorney's fees. So at that time, when it came before the city council was asking the administration to not pursue attorney's fees against the representatives of Ms. Hahn. However, that passed the city council by a vote of 5-4 in favor. It went up to the mayor's office, and the mayor's office vetoed that legislation, and that veto was sustained. And so The formal policy directive to not pursue attorney's fees never went into place, and City Legal at that time continued to pursue those attorney's fees and was ultimately awarded $5,000. So that was the distinction. The second is the pathway in the state courts, as I referenced earlier, with the order that the cause of death be changed.
So then my last question is, so if we did a two-week deferral, could we encourage the administration to come to terms, some type of settlement?
Madam President, I believe that's what I heard Mr. Royale suggesting, the path that they would be pursuing anyway. And so certainly in this forum, you could make that type of encouragement vocally or otherwise without passing a resolution.
Okay. Our city attorney.
Thank you, Madam President. I think there has been a lot of discussion between ordinances, resolutions, memorandums of support, and I would believe that when you're passing a resolution, your staff counsel said it himself, you are setting something that you're expecting an internal policy to be kept. I think the putting in the ambiguous language of should or shall makes this even more messy about whether or not this is a violation of the anti-donation clause. But I still believe it is. I also believe that, you know, putting this in place does inhibit our ability to continue to try to have our settlement talks with the Hahn attorney. I would like to, if anybody had questions about that, you know, because this is an open session, I couldn't do that in open session, but would be able to address those in a private session. I do want to address the comment that, you know, nothing was done. There have been good faith discussions, and we are trying to continue those good faith discussions. And so I would ask that you give us a deferral to allow us to be able to take that one last step. Other things that have happened in this case is not only in the federal courts has this gone up to the 10th Circuit and been denied, but has gone all the way up to the New Mexico Supreme Court, and the case has been dismissed on a motion for dismissal, which means that the courts took the complaint, saying everything in this complaint we're going to take as factually true, and they dismissed the matter. I do believe that there is a huge liability in opening up more plaintiffs to file and believing that they can come to you and ask for this type of relief. So I think that, you know, when we ask for attorneys' fees and costs, it's never to be malicious, at least in my experience in the city legal department, but rather recouping our money back into the risk management fund. So I think these are all things to consider. I'm happy to discuss any of the steps that city legal has done to settle this matter with the Hahn estate in a private setting. And thank you for listening.
Thank you, Councilor Winter.
Thank you, Madam President. This is a tough one, because Councilor Gibson, I do agree. I think there was a lot of issues here. The problem is when we talk about resolution, I can remember one administration that the city would pass a resolution and the mayor at that time would ignore that resolution. And so it's like we're asking to send a resolution up and then giving them the option to not pass that, to not put that resolution. So that puts us at odds too, because there was a couple times that happened with the council. The other thing is, if there is even a chance of it to be an issue, I mean, my last vote on the council is gonna come up that there could be a lawsuit because of this issue. That's what I'm concerned about.
Any other questions?
So, okay, I made a few notes.
I just wanted to ask her to reconsider.
I did go to City Legal 1 year ago, heard nothing. But even beyond that, this ruling for the $5,000 is 4 years old. And there's been no movement, to my knowledge, coming up with an agreement between parties on that. In fact, City Legal came to me about a week ago. Kind of out of the blue, I heard, you know, from Legal that they wanted a meeting to talk about this, which I welcomed. So, first of all, this is less about the $5,000 than it is making a statement for us to end this chapter and move on. It does set precedents, as much as any other resolution sets precedents. But also what we have done is set a precedence even before that by getting going to the court and asking for court costs. And that message that we're sending is that citizens who are asking for a resolution for their disputes with the city can expect retaliation from the city in the form of court costs to be paid. I don't think that's a good idea at all. That's a very bad message to send. So that we've already set that precedence. The other thing is that there are thousands of dollars that are owed to this city that we realistically will not collect and don't really expect to collect and are not working on collecting that. So I don't know if there's anything more, but I'll yield to anyone else on council or to go forward.
Did you want to say something?
And Madam President, Councilor, I don't think a two-week deferral, at least if the administration promises they'll work on it and get something done so they can bring it back to the next meeting, then I think that would be, it's waited this long and, you know, as far as maybe we can look more into the issue of, is it illegal for us to pass this or not? I just have concerns about that.
Is that in the form of a motion?
No, I'll let someone else talk and just see, but I don't think it hurt anything.
Councilor Benton.
No, I support the intent of this bill, but I don't see the votes appear to try to act on it tonight. I'm just going to lay that out there. I'd rather keep it alive and have the discussions with the administration and come back at it.
Anyone else? Councilor Borrego?
I would ask Councilor Gibson if you would reconsider a deferral, and maybe 2 weeks is too short of a time, maybe a month. And then we can act on it then. Because I support your intent, I mean, but I still have reservations about the anti-donation. I have reservations about, you know, are we setting a precedence? I remember cases like the Torres case, for example, that comes to mind from, you know, Taylor Ranch area. And I mean, there's probably a million other cases that are probably different, but maybe they had some, you know, debt. And did we, you know, are we setting a precedence? And I think that we are. And I think that when we're involved with legal issues like this, especially when it affects some, you know, the life of an individual, you know, and I spoke to Councilor Gibson about this. I mean, we're kind of opening up a Pandora's box a little bit, and it makes me very uncomfortable. So, and I'm not hearing our attorneys agree. You know, so that's the other thing that's really bothersome to me, is that we have two different attorneys sitting in front of us, and they're telling us two different things, and it's making me very, very uncomfortable to vote on this tonight.
Was there a motion in there? There was not a motion, right? Anyone else? Councilor Gibson to close.
I think we've all seen the anti-donation reason tossed up in front of us whenever the administration gets a little antsy, a little nervous. You know, I'm sure everyone here remembers whenever 5 years ago, I believe, when a very similar resolution was put up, passed by this body, Mayor Berry vetoed it, and that was after the city attorney argued that the Mary Hahn suit was a serious case, was not a serious case, it was frivolous. He was wrong. This is not a frivolous case. The courts did rule that the Office of Medical Investigation should change the cause of death from suicide to undetermined due to a flawed investigation. This is blatantly an acknowledgement of a serious case. This resolution should be passed since collecting court costs is not in the best interest of the city because Ms. Hahn's case is not and never has been a frivolous case. A woman died under suspicious circumstances. She was a mother and she was a sister who had immediate and long-term plans for her life. With the current status of Mary Hahn's case, the message is that lodging a serious complaint results in the city seeking repayment of those court costs. It could be argued that it's both unnecessarily punitive and actually double taxing for someone who is trying to settle dispute with the city. But what I think is most important is that we need to close this very sad and very disappointing chapter of Albuquerque's history. This story is not going to be forgotten anytime soon. The Hahn family has suffered for years, first in the grieving for their lost sister and mother, and then afterwards going through court cases. They've been through enough. The memory of Ms. Hahn has been denigrated, and it's hurt this city. People of Albuquerque want to see this end, and we have an opportunity tonight to end it on the best possible note. I see that I don't have full support, and I'm really tempted just to call for a vote and get everybody on record for that. But as I said, the most important part for me on this is that we try to restore just a little bit of dignity back to Ms. Hahn's name and to give the family some compassion. So that will not happen if this resolution fails. You know, one other thing I want to say, you're right, all those claims were not held up in a court of law. And there was a reason for that. There was no evidence. And there was a reason for the no evidence. And that's because the crime scene, as we've heard Mr. McCutcheon say, was trampled by the city, people from the city. And to worry about anti-donation for a resolution, I think is just absurd. But again, I realize I'm not going to get the votes. I thought I had the votes. I'm, you know, really disappointed. But I will move for a 2-week deferral.
There's a motion and a second for a 2-week deferral. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Opposed, no. Motion passes. There being no further business, this city council meeting is adjourned. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, everyone.